Well, afternoon now, and welcome to Lunch and Learn, brought to you by Gathering Place. Our special guest today is Sandra Ard, and today is June 21st, 2024. Sandy is an elder care attorney specializing in Texas estate law. Thank you for joining us today, Sandy.
Thank you for having me again. I spoke with in person last week and really enjoyed meeting your whole team and everybody in the community. From what I understand today, we're going to be doing a summary of what we talked about last week and then just a Q&A on any kind of information and questions that you have. Is that correct? Okay. All righty. I see a lot of people are on mute, and we do have the open chat on the bottom of your screen where it says chat in the little talk bubble. And so if anybody needs to type in a question or ask a question, you can open your mic. We're going to start off with a little bit about what is elder law, and then our focus today would be Medicaid. We are an elder law firm that focuses on the disability phase between being completely independent at home and passing away. When you're home and independent, you may see an estate planning attorney to get your wills and powers of attorney in place. And then, of course, after you pass away, your family may need to go to a probate attorney to get the assets to the next generation or to the beneficiaries. What I do is the in-between. When I started practicing elder law, it was between 3 and 5 years that we would have a family as a client talking about the disability phase and using the powers of attorney at the banks and using the powers of attorney with the life insurance companies and now telephone companies and electric companies and things like that. And then they would pass away, and we would also focus on trying to avoid probate. Now we have the same families going on 20 years because our disability phase has gotten longer thanks to medicine and science. So elder law is the practice of protecting your assets in the event of a disability. Our main focus is Medicaid eligibility in home or in a skilled nursing home, and then veterans aid and attendance. Today, we're going to talk about Medicaid in a skilled nursing facility. And a lot of families are very, very surprised to hear that you do not have to be indigent to qualify for Medicaid. Medicaid is health insurance. It supplements your Medicare. You don't choose between Medicare and Medicaid. Medicaid supplements your Medicare. It pays 20% in co-pays and deductibles once you are on Medicaid. With Medicare, of course, you qualify when you turn 65 or after you've been disabled for 2 years. With Medicaid, you have to pass 4 tests to qualify. The first test is medical need. They're not going to give Medicaid to you and me if you're happy and independent and living on your own. The second test is the 5-year look back on gifts and transfers. I'm going to talk about that in a little bit more in a second. The third test is income, and the fourth test is assets. So when we talk about medical necessity, that's the number one test. That's a medical test. That's not a legal test. I'm not a doctor or a nurse. I cannot say that you qualify for Medicaid medically, but we do work with the doctors, the nurses, the neurologists, the oncologists, the nursing homes to see what your level of care is and what your needs are. There's 5 activities of daily living: bathing, feeding, clothing, transitioning from chair to bed, bed to chair, and toileting. Then we add medication management. Are you a fall risk? Are you on blood thinners? Do you have memory issues? All of those factors play a part as to whether or not you rise to that level of skilled nursing. If you cannot do 2 of the 5, then you meet medical necessity. We have a question. What are the advantages of putting your home in a trust? We're going to talk about that in just a minute. Perfect. Good question. So test number 2 is the 5-year look back on gifts and transfers. Just because you have given something away in the last 5 years does not mean you're disqualified for 5 years. Medicaid divides the value of that gift by $242 per day. And what that means is if you gave away a $7,500 car, they're going to divide that by 242, and that gives you a 30-day penalty. So it may be worth it to give assets away. My client this morning just sold mom and dad's house. And then dad passed away, so it's now all mom's. They got $100,000 out of this house. He's going to be able to gift himself $80,000 of that and use the other $20,000 to pay the penalty for giving the asset, the cash away. And so when it comes to Medicaid, we have to know how much did you give away? What's your monthly income? And what's the day rate at the nursing home? And we can get down to the penny on what, how much you can give away and how much you have to keep to pay the nursing home for those penalty days. Test number three is income. An applicant has to be below 2829 of gross income. That means you add back in the Medicare, you add back in the federal income tax withholdings. And if you're below that, then you do not need a Miller Trust. If you're above that, you have to open a Miller Trust, which is basically seven pages on how to balance this one checking account. Income goes in, you pay your medical premiums, you give yourself your $75 allowance for the last 25 years. It's been $60. We just changed it to $75. And then the rest goes to the nursing home. But if you have a spouse, we have to know what your spouse makes first and then give you your spouse a diversion. I had somebody call it alimony, like nursing home alimony. If you're in the nursing home, you have to give your spouse alimony. That's kind of like a good analogy there. So we have to know what your spouse makes as well. And then the last test is assets. When it comes to assets, it's just like doing your taxes. We have to take your exempt assets off the top, and then we convert assets that may not be exempt into exempt assets. And then whatever's left is what we have to spend down. And I hate that word spend down, because really, most of the time, you don't have to spend it. You just have to shift it from one pocket to another. Like you may have to, you may want to gift some and put the money in a trust for the next generation. If you have to shift it to your spouse, you may have to filter it through an annuity. So now you're converting assets into an income stream. But Medicaid will not tell you that your exempt asset is exempt. You have to know to take that exemption, just like knowing to take that deduction for your IRS return, your tax return. So we have a lot of families that don't realize that your house is exempt. One car is exempt. Certain kinds of life insurance are exempt. Your funeral is exempt if it's non-refundable. Some of them are, some of them are not. You just check a box. IRAs and 401ks are now exempt. That's such a new rule. It's not even in the rule book. So when it comes to Medicaid, it's just like doing your taxes. We have to know all the paperwork so we can tell Medicaid, I'm taking this exemption, I'm taking this deduction. And then everybody talks about estate recovery. Oh, if you get on Medicaid, they're going to come take your house. That is not the case in Texas. There are exemptions and deductions on Medicaid estate recovery, MERP, M-E-R-P. I always say this is the big old ugly scary bill they send you after somebody passes away. Married couples are completely exempt from ever having to pay Medicaid estate recovery back. Don't pay them. They will gladly take a check if you want to give it to them, but don't. You don't have to. If you have a single adult child living in your home, you may be exempt from having to pay the state back in that situation. If you have any special needs or Social Security disabled adult kids or even grandkids, they're exempt from having to pay Medicaid back. So when it comes to that bill at the end, it's always good not to rush to the courthouse steps with the will, because if you do, the first thing the judge says is, were they on Medicaid and how much do they owe them? Let's pay them back. When in reality, you may not have to pay them back at all. So, so when it comes to Medicaid, there's four tests: Medicaid, medical necessity, the 5-year look back on gifts or transfers, income and assets. And then we always want to talk about probate avoidance. If you can avoid going to the judge, you can avoid paying Medicaid. So let's look at some questions. What are the advantages of putting your home in a trust? Thank you, Linda. Great question. Depends on the trust. If it's a revocable living trust, this makes your home countable for Medicaid purposes. That is the one asset that is not countable when it's in your own name, but if you put it in a trust, it is countable. A lot of people will put checking accounts and savings accounts. Well, they were countable to begin with. So they're going to be countable in the trust, but at least it's easier to manage those accounts. We have to take a lot of homes out of trusts to get them qualified for Medicaid. And what we do then is a ladybird deed. A ladybird deed is a beneficiary designation on real estate. Can be used for homesteads, lands, lots, mineral rights. It avoids probate, and therefore it avoids Medicaid estate recovery. The ladybird deed can also be known as the transfer on death deed. There's a few little differences, but at the end of the road, both of them avoid probate. Both of them avoid Medicaid. If you cannot sign for yourself, which many of my families are at that point, they're already in a crisis. They cannot sign anymore. Then we have to look to your financial power of attorney to see if they're allowed to sign. So when it comes to doing these ladybird deeds, one of the most important documents in my practice all day, every day, is that statutory durable financial power of attorney. And it does need to be a little stronger than the fill in the blank that you can find online. So we are in Galveston County. We do have windstorm and floods, and knock on wood, hopefully not next week or last week. But a lot of families say that, well, if I go into a nursing home and nobody's here to manage my house and my kids are stuck paying my windstorm and flood and property taxes, let's put the house in an irrevocable trust and get that 5-year clock ticking. Let's protect that house later on down the road by go ahead and getting that 5-year clock ticking. And that way, if 5 years from now, my kids decide to sell my house, then it does not count against me or them, and they keep the money in the trust. We do a lot of land trusts for the camp house, the hunting lease, the lake house, those extra, the beach house, those extra properties that are not your homestead. So we want to get that 5-year clock ticking as early as possible to protect the real estate as well as the cash flow if it does sell later on down the road. So the advantages of putting it in an irrevocable trust are asset protection. The advantages of putting it in a revocable trust is management. So it's easy to manage. Okay. Question. We have almost gone through our life savings to care for my husband who has Alzheimer's. Now I must go into the hospital for surgery maybe several months before I've recovered enough to care for him. Will Medicare cover anything for him to go into a nursing home a while? There is a respite program through Medicare, but from what I understand, it's only 3 nights, and it's more, it helps the caregiver get some respite to take a vacation, to get out for the weekend, to heal themselves. As far as facilities go, there, you're at home, you're independent, you may bring in some caregivers, which it sounds like you're at right now. Then you can have assisted living. There are more community environment, just management of day-to-day needs. And then you have skilled nursing. But off to the side, we have this whole realm of personal care homes, small houses in little communities, multiple beds, where somebody may go for a few months just while family members can get some respite or recover or do their own rehab, because we do see a lot of caregivers get injured caring for somebody else. So there's some options there. Some of them are private pay. Most of them are private pay. But many times when it comes to married couples, where one is in the nursing home and one is at home, even in the hospital or getting physical therapy, that the exemptions and the deductions make sense for you to go ahead and get him on Medicaid if you think he's going to be there more than a month or more than a few weeks. But that's only for skilled nursing care. That's not for personal care homes. It's not for assisted living. So it may be that you just take a look around and see if you can find a facility that will care for him for a good 4 to 6 weeks, private pay while you recover, or maybe this is the time to get him on Medicaid in a facility. So if this is Tina's question, if I assume my loved one might have to move to a nursing home not too far in the future, when is a good time to start preparations, paperwork, and see an attorney while they can still sign their name? That's a good time. We always say it's so much easier to plan when you're vertical, when you're standing up, than when you're horizontal, you're laying in bed. Typically, it's never too late to go ahead and get the planning done. But bottom line is, I need a really good, really strong financial power of attorney to get the financial acrobats done that I need to protect your property and your house. And a lot of times we have people who come in for what we call a pre-plan, just to get those ducks in a row, to see how strong their financial and legal health are. And many times they walk away and they know, okay, in a crisis, I'm okay. I have a plan when that time comes and my documents are strong enough for me to implement that plan. Other times we may just say, let's go ahead and get this ladybird deed done. Let's go ahead and get this power of attorney done. That way, when the time comes, you're ready. And very, very rarely we may say, that's a legacy asset. Let's go ahead and get an irrevocable trust and get that 5-year clock ticking. Could be the lake house, could be the hunt and lease. We have a lot of families from Baytown that have multi-generational Exxon stock from great, great grandpa that's worked there, then dad, then, you know, then grandpa. So when it comes to those legacy items, it may be good to go ahead and get that irrevocable trust done and start that 5-year clock on that asset. So we are free consultations, and it just helps me to educate the community to know later on down the road, you're ready to go with the right paperwork at the right time. So Tina's got another question on who decides whether a person with Alzheimer's is permitted to live in a nursing home. Does Medicare or Medicaid have the right to say yes or no? Yes, they do. It's called a disability determination. And what typically happens is most of the nursing homes will tell you, you're not going to qualify. You're just here for rehab. It's just a temporary issue. We're going to get you strong. You know, you're not going to qualify with a chronic ongoing illness. Other times we have family members that may have had a patient slip and fall and break a hip, but they slipped because they had a stroke or they have dementia and their legs are starting to droop. And so if Medicaid denies medical necessity, we work with the nursing home to look in the computer and say, oh, well, yeah, he's here for a broken hip, but he also has hypertension, diabetes, dementia. He's on blood thinners. He's a fall risk. And so they need to put the whole picture in the computer so Medicaid sees he's not just there for a broken hip. This is why he broke his hip. So you can argue if you are denied medical necessity for Medicaid. So did somebody have a question? Okay. So what happens if the person with Alzheimer's is not willing to sign any kind of document, power of attorney, medical power of attorney? So medically, you are allowed to speak for somebody if they cannot speak for themselves. If you are if somebody cannot speak for themselves, their spouse can speak for them. If they have no spouse, then we look down to the children. If they have no children, we look up to the parents. If they have no parents, we look sideways to the siblings. So there's a legal hierarchy of who can speak if you cannot speak for yourself. The problem is sometimes they can speak for themselves and they don't realize the ramifications of what they're saying. So financially, there is no such hierarchy. If you don't have that piece of paper, you're not talking to the banks or the life insurance company. So then you have to get a guardianship. A guardianship can take about 6 months to get in front of the judge and say, I'm taking this person's rights to make their own financial and medical decisions away from them. That's a very high level of authority. The judges really don't like to do this a lot. And many times they'll ask the person, do you know that this is a bad choice? Do you know by not taking this medication, not getting this physical therapy, not going to the nursing home, not hoarding, hoarding papers and food and things like that? Do you know these are bad decisions? And if they say, yeah, I do, and I'm okay with that, then the judge will not grant guardianship. So it's a very high hurdle to get to. But many times when it comes to people not wanting to sign powers of attorney, it's just that they haven't been educated on it. A lot of times they think, I'm giving my power away. You're going to be able to overrule me. You're going to be able to stick me in a nursing home, even if I don't want to be there. And so many times we have to just educate them that no, as long as you can speak for yourself, nobody's going to be overruling your medical authority, and you are sharing financial power of attorney, both of you. If you call the bank up and say, don't give my agent anything, then they're not going to give it to them. So,
Sandy, may I jump in with a question along that same vein?
Yes.
How does this compare with a declaration of
guardian?
No, not guardian, of incompetence. I know with my father-in-law, it was very easy. It was one meeting with the psychiatrist and then the attorney. And I understood by having that declaration of incompetence, he could not sign a contract and I could trump him, his voice, over medical decisions. Is that recommended nowadays to just have a declaration of incompetence?
That's the first step to using a springing financial power of attorney. If the power of attorney says in the fine print, this is only effective if I'm declared incompetent, then we have to get that declaration. The other powers of attorney say it's effective immediately and we share authority. So the declaration of incompetency would be, did you already have powers of attorney?
My father-in-law had a whole trust book with everything in a revocable trust. And then when either he or his spouse passed, it became irrevocable. And it was along with the documents for medical power of attorney, durable power of attorney, will, pour over will, et cetera, the seven documents.
Yes, yes, that's perfect. And chances are he may have been trustee of his own trust. And it said, and the trust probably said it itself, I'm trustee until I'm declared incompetent. So that declaration probably worked in multiple different parts of that estate planning package.
Yes, so, but this had to be in addition to the estate planning package.
Yes, yes, to bring up the next person with authority to make these decisions. Yeah.
Do you recommend that for people who have a loved one with Alzheimer's to go ahead and do the declaration of incompetence? Especially when you have someone who doesn't wish to sign papers.
If it's necessary, yes, yes. The problem is when you have Alzheimer's and dementia, it's not black and white. It's not an on and off switch. You may have good days and bad days, and the doctors are very reluctant to sign a declaration of capacity or incapacity until it's very, very late in the stages. And so typically what you have is a springing financial power of attorney or a trust that says, I'm in charge until I'm declared I can't be in charge. And so when you have those kinds of papers, you have to get that declaration of incapacity for the next person to step up and be able to have that authority. So it helps, but it's not as easy as what y'all went through, especially nowadays. But and then some of these documents say I need two doctors to say that. So
yes, we had to have a medical and a psychiatrist. I believe Linda has something that she'd like to say.
I have a question. Okay, so we have a power of attorney, which I thought was good, but now that you're saying that it may not be thorough enough, and he's already signed that one, and I do agree, his cognitive skills some days are better than others. So it'd be hard to say he can't sign. His problem is he has a severe macular degeneration. He's legally blind. And so I pretty much have to sign anything for him anyway. How would I get a new power of attorney done when he's legally blind? How do you get people to sign?
Okay.
And I asked that in the chat box, so you can ignore it.
Okay. Texas has different avenues for notaries. So if they, and legally blind, he can hold a pen, and does he have a signature, or does he make an X, or?
No, he can, it just might be, you might not be able to read it, and it might be all across the page because he can't see. I mean, he tries.
Yeah. So Texas says if he can make a mark on a piece of paper, that is his signature. And he can sign in front of a notary, just like we have stroke patients that can't move their arms at all. But if they can indicate or communicate that they want somebody to sign on their behalf, then the notary can sign on their behalf in front of two witnesses. So there's different avenues of getting these documents signed, as long as they can understand in a moment of lucidity.
Okay.
He's signing a piece of paper, giving somebody else authorization to manage his finances. So as long as he understands that and can communicate it, whether by blinking an eye or shaking their head or any other way, then the notary can sign on his behalf.
But okay, so if
Texas does say that if he can make an X or any kind of mark on that paper, then the notary cannot sign on his behalf.
I got you. Okay, so, but if I have a current power of attorney, or I get the upgraded one, could I put something in trust? I don't need his signature for anything once I get the durable power of attorney. Could I put something in trust without his?
So this is signature? Your husband, right?
Yes, he's my husband.
Yes. Typically if you own jointly owned property, you can put that property in the trust. If it's a revocable living trust, yes. If it's an irrevocable trust, it depends. If it's inherited property, if it's mineral rights, those are sole separate property. You would have to use your power of attorney for that.
If it's a property he held before we got married, would that be, I couldn't do anything with that one maybe?
Correct. Correct. Okay. You would need to use your power of attorney to move that asset into the trust.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Okay, Sandy, Beverly was asking, what is included in your free consultation?
That's a good question.
We do ask you for a lot of homework. We do ask you for income, for assets, and even the kinds of assets you have. Because like I said, a checking account versus an IRA or 401k has two totally different sets of rules. An annuity has a different set of rules. So we do ask for very defined documents for our consultations. And then we go over them line by line, as if you were in a crisis today, what you would have to do. And they are usually between an hour to 2 hours long.
Wow.
Thank you. And Marina was asking, do people sometimes get a divorce to qualify for Medicaid?
Up until about 3 months ago, I would have said I've never recommended a divorce for Medicaid. But 3 months ago, I did have a client who had inherited a little over $2 million. Mm-hmm. And they would have had to do a spend down of down to $150,000 to qualify for their spouse. His payment to the nursing home would have been about, I think it was like $150 a month. It was nothing. It was very worth it, but not to that magnitude. And so it's her sole separate property. It's an inheritance, but it is subject to medical debt because they're married. So in this situation, I told her she may want to seek a divorce attorney. They'd been separated for 8 years. So it wasn't like I offered it. It was just like, you know, it's time. And after the divorce, his payment to the nursing home was going to be about $2,200, but it saved her from having to spend down $2 million out of an investment account that she just inherited from her father. So, that's in my 25 years of practice, that's the only time I've ever recommended a divorce. But like I said, she had already spoken to a divorce attorney 8 years ago, 5 years ago, 3 years ago. And now she was trying to take care of her husband who'd had a stroke. And I was like, well, maybe it's time.
Beverly also had a question concerning a person who does not recognize that they have dementia. And how do you go about taking over for their legal documents? And I believe you answered that when you talked about the declaration of incompetence.
Yeah, if it's springing and it says in the document you have to have a doctor's letter, then you're going to have to get that doctor's letter. If it's immediate, it says this a power of attorney is immediately effective, then you don't. You can use it as if they were standing side by side with you. One caveat is that if he's standing there at the bank with you and he says, I didn't sign that, that's not mine, I want to revoke it, then they have to listen to him. He can revoke it at any time. So you have to be very careful when what I call poking that fire ant hill. It may just be that you take it to the financial institutions and you have them approve it first. And then you do whatever kind of planning you need to do. And remember, when you do have a power of attorney for somebody, you're acting on their behalf for their benefit. So, in the last couple of years, the law has actually added that if they have an existing estate plan, you cannot do anything to disrupt that estate plan. You can't go in and make yourself beneficiary of everything if he left it all to his daughter from a prior marriage. You cannot go in there and make yourself the only beneficiary if there's five other kids and the will says to all my kids equally. So you do have to honor the existing estate plan now if you are the power of attorney financially.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, we sure appreciate you taking time to chat with us today. Does anyone else have any questions? I see Linda's raising her hand. Would you go ahead and turn on your sound, please, Linda?
How far up are you booked? When can we get a free consultation?
I'm usually booked 2 to 3 weeks out. So, okay. And a lot of people, at first they kind of think that's pretty far out, but then when you see the list of homework I give you.
So we'll get an email with instructions like, you know, I'm guessing bring your current 7 documents. We'll look at those, but also list of your assets, specific what your assets are, sources of income, all that kind of stuff, and whatever else you ask for. So a big package.
Yes, ma'am. You'll get a list of documents to bring. And then a little intake form, you know, tell me a little bit about your family. Tell me a little bit about your finances, that kind of thing. So it is an investment in time. But a lot of families are like, well, this was a very good, hard exercise. Now I know what my life insurance is about. Now I know who my beneficiaries are. Now I know the bank dropped my beneficiary off my last CD.
Okay. What about my 96-year-old mother? I don't even know what paperwork she has, and I would have to come in for her. Could I do a consultation on both me and my mom at the same time?
Yes. Typically, we will either do them back to back. We'll do you first and then your mom, or sometimes we can try and squeeze them together. Okay. I will tell you the biggest threat to your family is your family.
Yes. Yes.
Getting their paperwork in order is very, very important, whether they're over 18 teenagers or whether they're over 90 parents.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just nervous about her. I mean, she turns 97 this year, so I'm going to have to be dealing with, if nothing else, probate within the next few years. So I want to make sure we have her stuff in order too.
Yeah. And I do a big talk on probate avoidance, and just a little blip. Give me 2 minutes.
Okay, I want to hear this.
In Texas, we have limited probate. What that means is if there's a joint owner on a bank account, it goes sideways first to the joint owner. If there is no joint owner, then it goes down to beneficiary, payable on death, transfer on death, beneficiary. If there's no beneficiary, then it goes through the will. So the will is just for the leftovers. And I will tell you that when it comes to the adding a joint owner, you really have to ask the bank, how they have you on an account. Just because you're on the bank statement doesn't mean you're the joint owner. You could just be on there as a convenience signer, just to sign checks. You could just be on there as a co-signer for some sort of debt. So you have to really walk into the bank and ask them, am I going to avoid probate with this account? And sometimes they'll avoid probate on accident. You may be adding a family member to an account for convenience. And the little girl behind the counter says, let me help you avoid probate and make them joint owner. And now they go in a car, get in a car wreck or get a divorce. And that account is theirs as well because they're jointly owned. In Texas, they consider joint owned checking accounts. You own 100%, they own 100%. It's not 50-50. It's 100-100. So you can avoid probate in Texas by adding a joint owner or a beneficiary on almost everything. Checking accounts, savings accounts, money markets, mutual funds, CDs, stocks, bonds, cars have a beneficiary designation now. And then the house has the ladybird deed or the transfer on death deed. So you can easily avoid probate. Just make sure it's on purpose and it's the right way. And the will is really the catch-all, but it is the guiding document to all the actions we take during life.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Any other questions? Well, it was a good crew today. I hope I'm invited back. Like I said, we do talks on veterans aid and attendance for the veterans and widows. We do probate avoidance. We do the basics of estate planning documents. We talk about the revocable trust, the irrevocable trust, powers of attorney, and then, of course, our Medicaid for the middle class.